So welcome for the third session, the second of today, focusing on Eastern Mediterranean, Greece as a strategic interpreter between China and Europe, question mark. Chair is Athanasios Platias. No need to say anything further. The chair, the floor is yours.
Okay, we will continue our discussion. In the first panel, we discuss generically about the Belt and Road Initiative. Now we will localize it. We will bring it in the Eastern Mediterranean. So we have a distinguished panel that they will try to see what it means for Eastern Mediterranean, what it means for Greece, and whether Greece can play a role of either strategic interpreter or any other role in this initiative and utilizing our geographic advantages. I will now turn the floor to Professor Papasotiriou. Professor Papasotiriou is Professor of International Relations and Strategic Studies at Panteion University, and he has written one of the best books on China, history and current politics, in the Greek literature, which we use in our university, which is used in Padio. So, Professor Papasotiriou, you should enrich us with your wisdom.
Yeah. Right. In a minute. All right, I will try to talk about the somewhat improbably significant relationship between China and Greece. Improbably because China is the country with the largest population in the world, the second largest economy. Greece is a country with 11 million people and a GDP that is about number 36, 37 in the world. So one wouldn't expect the relationship to be particularly significant. And yet, somehow, it's disproportionately significant in relation to the great disparity in the size of the two countries. And surely the background to this relationship is that both are countries with a very long past, great civilizations going back many millennia. And only few countries can boast such a lengthy and significant world historical past, which is presumably the reason why Greece was one of the first European countries to develop a significant relationship with China in the last years of Mao's rule. In 1973, the deputy prime minister of Greece, the now long forgotten Mr. Makarezos, visited China and stayed there for 1 week. I mean, it was very, very soon after Nixon's opening to China. Greece became interested. Now, let me first focus on the economics, the economic relationship, and why Greece and China have become rather significant to one another in economic terms. And I will focus on two aspects. The first has to do with two engines of growth for China. If you look at Chinese growth in the last 30 years, the last three decades, the two main engines of growth have been construction, public works, plus private construction and housing, new cities emerging, cities expanding, cities becoming larger, construction, and the second is exports. Both of these are now coming to reaching some limits, and we're seeing the Chinese model of development facing some challenges and the necessity to move away from construction and exports. But certainly these have been very important engines of growth for the Chinese economy in the last decades. And Greece has played a significant role in both, improbably enough. Regarding construction, the amazing Chinese construction boom that as I said, was one of the two main engines of growth in China in the last 30 years, necessitated a vast, vast imports of raw materials primarily from Latin America and Australia to China. And these imports were transported by the world's leading shipping economy, which was the Greek shipping. Right. Greek shipping specializes not so much on regular routes, which could be compared to bus routes on land. It's more like a taxi service. If you need an ad hoc transportation service, you go to the Greek ship owners. And this is what the Greek ship owners provided. Greek ship owners became really wealthy. They made a lot of money out of the needs for the of the Chinese economy to import raw materials from Latin America and Australia. A strange symbiosis, right? The leading shipping nation in the world and the leading construction country in the world working together, making a sort of in a complementary fashion. And the second has to do with Chinese exports. Which Chinese exports necessitated first ports that would provide them the ability to transport vast amounts of containers in huge container ships that would allow them then to bring their products to the main markets, and I'm talking about the European market, which is where Greece is one of the gateways. And exports also created huge trade surpluses and thus an accumulation of currency, which resulted in the need for China to invest these enormous currency reserves outside its economy, searching for investment projects. And this has resulted in the Belt and Road Initiative, right, a need to use these currency reserves to invest outside China, and various investment projects then sort of were brought under one umbrella in the One Belt, One Road Initiative, which now is known as the Belt and Road Initiative. And in both of these respects, both the need to transport container products outside from China to the main markets in Europe, and in the Belt and Road Initiative, finding investment projects, Greece has become a significant focus for Chinese activity. And this is because of Piraeus, the port of Piraeus. Now, the port of Piraeus has several unique characteristics. First of all, it's deep enough so that it can handle even the largest container ships in the world. The port is a depth of 18 meters, right? And thus, for the Chinese, investing in Piraeus became, first of all, one of the best or leading projects of the what now is known as the Belt and Road Initiative. If you visit the National Museum of China in Tiananmen Square, which is really a museum that presents the successes of the Chinese regime. And the current exhibition has to do with the successes of the Chinese regime in the last 40 years, since December 1978, when Deng Xiaoping began his reforms that resulted in the great transformation of the Chinese economy to the second largest in the world. You have three large pictures of Piraeus. I mean, it's amazing if you go as a Greek that you see. It's a success project. It's a project that is seen evidently in China. A win-win project, beneficial both for Piraeus and for Chinese trade. Why? Well, huge containers can transport vast amounts of Chinese export products to Piraeus, and from Piraeus it then gets retransported to ports, to dozens of ports, from Italy to the Eastern Mediterranean and the Black Sea. It's really a hub, Piraeus, servicing many ports in our broader region. And Piraeus is very centrally located. And now we are hoping that soon there will be also rail links that will allow the transportation on land, but through rail, into parts of Central Europe, which currently are being serviced through rail routes from Rotterdam and Amsterdam, but that means that you have to go all the way around Europe, whereas if you had rail routes from Piraeus, then it would be a shorter sea route. Thus, Piraeus has become a very important project for the Chinese. And thus, for these two reasons, construction serviced by Greek shipping and Chinese exports serviced by Piraeus, plus that Piraeus is one of the most successful individual projects of the Belt and Road Initiative, the bilateral economic relationship has become unusually important, given that Greece is a rather small country and small economy, disproportionately important. Let me now turn to Greek public opinion regarding the Greek and Chinese relationship. If you look at surveys taken in Greece over the last 10 years, since 2010, some of the most important findings are that Greek opinions are negative on China on a number of aspects that have to do with the domestic situation, the standard of living. Greeks believe that the standard of living in China is low, working conditions are harsh, the environment is not being protected enough, even though I think in recent years Chinese policy has changed. But also, Greeks are critical about human rights. On the other hand, Greeks are very positive regarding the rise of China in the world, which is interesting. I mean, we're part of NATO, part of the EU, and yet Greek public opinion is not alarmed by the rise of China. Greeks are also somewhat scared of globalization and view China as a potential help for Greece, maybe because of what Professor Platias mentioned, the disappointment with German policy towards Greece and therefore disillusioned with Europe. But I think the most significant finding when you look at Greek public opinion is that 9 out of 10 Greeks support closer cultural ties between Greece and China. And thus there's a scope there for us to develop a closer and more intense dialogue regarding culture. Apart from the economic aspects that I mentioned earlier, that we exploit the fact that we are both countries with very ancient traditions, ancient civilizations, and how we can translate this into a significant cultural dialogue in the current era. Now, the scope for Greek-Chinese relations is limited by geopolitical realities. I mean, regardless of what opinion polls suggest about positive attitudes that Greeks have towards China's rise, Greece is part of the West. Greece's fundamental alliances are NATO and the EU, and this will not change. I mean, we are deeply anchored in the West. We see that in the last few years in the European Union and in the United States, there's a newfound alarm about Chinese influence. There are new perceptions in the EU that China uses its Belt and Road Initiative and the 17+1 relationship somehow to gain geopolitical access into the EU, to try to play off the eastern parts of the EU against the more dominant western parts, exploit internal divisions within the EU. Yeah. And we understand that we cannot go against the dominant positioning within the EU or NATO, and thus this sets a clear limit to the relationship. We want to have as close an economic and cultural relationship with China as possible, but always within the fundamental Greek orientation that we're part of the West, part of NATO and the EU, and thus this sets the limits of the relationship. All right, thank you very much.
Syrigos.
I think the introduction of Professor Papasotiriou tied well with what we discussed in the previous panel on how European countries, and especially Greece, are being torn between their geoeconomic interest and their geopolitical position. And you highlighted the limits of what Greece can do, but on the other time, you highlighted commonality of interest on the maritime level, on Greece becoming an important transportation hub. The positive aspects of the Chinese image on the Greek public, and the importance of the civilization dialogue and the perception not only from China but also from the Greek side of China as a great civilizational power. So we will now turn to Dr. Song from the famous Institute of European Studies in the Chinese Academy of Social Science. We would like to thank her and her boss here for welcoming us during our trip in China. And I will say that Dr. Song is probably the number one expert in China on Greece. So we will now hear from the horse's mouth how the Chinese are viewing Greece. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for Last Garage Foundation and Tsinghua University to invite me to attend this very important seminar. And today I'm talking about the Belt and Road Initiative and Greece-China cooperation. And here I just briefly summarize the views of Chinese scholars on this issue, and I hope to discuss it with my colleague, Greek colleagues and friends here. And my speech has divided three parts: impetus, areas, and prospects. Firstly, in my 6 years of observation, and is a new driving force for China-Greece relations and the Belt and I think the Belt and Road Initiative is a new driving force for China-Greece relations, and the Belt and it has brought new areas of cooperation and a new perspective. Yes. And I think we can see from three aspects. And the first one is, you know, Belt and Road Initiative being high on the agenda of the top leadership, resulting in their infrequent interactions and mutual visits. You know, let's get the president where to meet our President Xi Jinping in these days. And the second one is we can see from the Belt and Road Initiative mutual interest in boosting economic development and trade exchanges. And the third one, we can see a push from local voices and private sectors. And we can see local governments and private enterprises support the Belt and the Road Initiative, the initiative programs and organize activities. And also in this process, I found there is a new milestones. We can see last year on 27th August, The two foreign ministers, Chinese foreign minister and the Greek foreign minister, signed an MOU, which has designed to have a positive impact on their bilateral ties, as well as Belt and Road initiatives. And I think the signing is a milestone and in Chinese and Greek cooperation against the dark forces you can see in America and in Europe, unilateralism and protectionism. And the official Chinese officials say the signing is like installing a new high-powered engine for China-Greece relations, injecting a strong and long-lasting impetus into the pragmatic cooperation between the two countries. And also the Chinese officials say this is a commitment to strengthen the integration of development strategies to promote the construction of Belt and Road Initiative and enhance coordination and cooperation in major international and regional affairs to jointly address global challenges. And also, I think there is the second milestone, and we can see this year Greece became the 18th full member of China CEC Cooperation. And my colleague, Professor Liu Zhoukui, do some research, and he will talk more. And so time is limited. I would say more. Yes. And also, I think from the milestones, we can see the cooperation areas. And the first one is we can see the bilateral economic cooperation and the trade exchanges into a second area. Because since the launch of BRI, China and Greece economic and trade relations have witnessed a leap forward, moving from being trade to investment driven. In particular, China's capital market is having increased interest in the Greek market. Besides the investment in Greece infrastructure construction, and their attention has extended to food processing, tourist services and facilities, scientific technology innovation, and the cultural industry, real estate, health care, something like that. And the vanguard of Chinese investment in Greece has mostly been state-owned companies backed by state policy, as everybody well knows. But now, major Chinese private enterprises are also increasing their footprint in Greece. You can see Alibaba, Huawei, and other private enterprises. And also we can see the second one, and the maritime, and then scholar professor talked more about that. And maritime cooperation has witnessed rapid development, even with a new cooperative model being on the rise. What it means? Over the past 6 years, BRI has constituted a new framework for China-Greece maritime cooperation, whose focus is experiencing a shift from traditional shipbuilding and maritime transport to port infrastructure, marine science and technology, marine economy, marine tourism, and marine culture, etc. And this is the third one, people-to-people exchanges like us, face-to-face talk. And China and Greece are having closer exchanges in the fields of tourism, culture, education, science and technology, media and academia. High-level and multi-tiered people-to-people and cultural exchanges are unfolding at an unprecedented pace. And China is stamping up its efforts to build a Chinese culture center in Athens, maybe other place, but master in Greece. China and Greece are actively promoting exchanging tourism, marine culture, and other fields. And from this one, I would like to show you my perspective. And firstly, China and Greece were further highlighting their high-level exchange and even integration of their civilizations within the BRI framework. And this would be an exemplary of how different civilizations can learn from each other. The second one is maybe the professor will talk more about the Port of Piraeus project. Would play a leading and exemplary role for China-Greece BI cooperation and even spill over to other areas. And I think the third one is China and Greece would further promote people-to-people exchanges to achieve mutual understanding between the two peoples. So the third one is the two sides would take advantage of the window of opportunity for Greece economic recovery and promote their bilateral cooperation through the Belt Road and Bond. And actually, I think many questions in my head, and I would like to know, and would like to know your opinions about what's a new impetus, or what's a new impetus for our cooperation? What's a new in milestones? Where is the next one? And what is new our cooperative areas? What's the next one? And we are expecting for our new future. So my conclusion is, along with Greece's economic recovery and development, China would seize the window of opportunity and further cooperate with Greece on the plan of Belt and Road, so as to create a model of Belt and Road cooperation between us and realize a moment rejuvenation of the two ancient civilizations. And in this process, China would accommodate Greek major concerns, such as investment and employment to promote economic recovery, and its appeal to play a role as a regional power in Southeast Europe and the Mediterranean region, and also support Greece to become a regional shipping and energy hub and a security stabilizer. And we welcome Greece putting forward its own ideas and plans in the Belt and Road Initiative, so that the two sides can jointly build a community of shared future with converging interests. So thank you for your kind attention. Thank you.
We have heard an excellent overview of the Greek-Chinese relation, not only at the Belt and Road Initiative, but the maritime aspect, the civilization aspect, the people-to-people exchanges, which I would like to add that both our universities, Panteion and the University of Piraeus, have Chinese students right now learning Greek and taking classes in Greek courses, which is something very interesting, and it's fascinating, and it's new, and it's growing to, and it's going to develop. And at a personal level, I must admit that I was surprised when I visited the academy. I could see a Chinese scholar specializing on Thucydides and quoting Aeschylus to me in Greek. So it was one of the highlights of my trip, seeing a young Chinese lady quoting Aeschylus on an ancient text which I could hardly be able to translate. So it shows that the Chinese are really investing also on the cultural and literal level, and the people-to-people exchanges. It's very important between the two great civilizations. I also, of course, note that the commonality of interest, mostly of Greece becoming a transportation hub, and Piraeus and the port is very important. So we should hear more about this project now by Mr. Nektarios Demenopoulos.
Good morning. First of all, I would like to thank Laskaridis Foundation for the kind invitation to attend this very interesting conference. We usually start the presentation about the Port of Piraeus by underlining what we consider the major asset of the port. And this is, of course, the geographical position of the port, because, as you can see, it is the first very large port after the crossing of Suez Tunnel. And this is extremely important for the economics of shipping companies to visit the port and use it as a major transshipment hub in order to send goods all over the Mediterranean Sea to other ports of Mediterranean and Black Sea. Of course, apart from this, it is very important the natural characteristics of the port, as analyzed very nice from Professor Papasotiriou. So I think I couldn't describe this better, the great importance of the natural characteristics. First of all, the natural depth of the port, which enables the port of Piraeus to facilitate the biggest, the huge, the mega container vessels that starting their route either from East Asia or from Northern Europe, and then with a smaller vessel that we call them feeders, to redistribute goods, whatever it is, containers or vehicles, to other ports of Mediterranean and Black Sea. So all these years has been developed a very wide network of cooperation with other ports of Mediterranean and Black Sea, and this is a very important advantage, the existing of this network for the port of Piraeus. Also, it was also referred to the rail connection of the port. This is a new development which started to operate the latest years, and this is another significant advantage for the port of Piraeus, because the route that was followed up to now, it was that the vessels crossing the Suez Channel go on through Gibraltar and arrive in the very big ports of Northern Europe, and then by rail send back cargo to Central and Eastern Europe. Now, by using the rail port of Piraeus and other facilities, the development of the rail network in Balkans and Central and Eastern Europe, we can save time for sending the products. I think all we understand that this is very important, especially for the shipping companies. For this, especially, time is money. And by using this route, it can be saved from 1 to 5, 6 days, depending on the final destination of the products. So this development, which is taking place also in the framework of the Belt and Road Initiative, it is very important. According to my opinion, there was no economic rationality by following the other route and going through Gibraltar to Northern Europe in order to send these products back to Central and Eastern Europe. So this is a very interesting development in the latest years, and I think it will be one of the next big things in the history of the port that will implement it, especially as the facilities are improved and we have the modernification of the rail network. Now, another characteristic of the port, it is that does not focus only one activity. It's not only a commercial port, not only the passenger port. It is, of course, the largest port of Greece, but also at the same time is the busiest port in terms of passenger traffic of whole Europe. Every year we serve more than 16 million passengers, so it is a huge number. But at the same time, it's one of the biggest port. It has one of the largest container terminals in Europe, and also one of the largest car terminals in Eastern Mediterranean. Also, the port of Piraeus has a very big ship repair zone, so we can understand that it can provide almost all the services to any kind of vessels. Now, having a closer view in the fields of cooperation that have been developed, especially with COSCO Shipping, we must know that this cooperation started before the Belt and Road Initiative, which announced in 2013. As you can see, in 2009, we have a very historical structural change in the history of the port, as it started a major concession for the development of the container terminal of Piraeus Port. After an international tender, the bidder of this international tender for the operation of PR2, the big one, container terminal pier, it was COSCO Shipping, the largest shipping group in the whole world, and started to operate this business by the end of 2009. Also undertook the obligation to construct a new pier, Pier 3, the left one, and to increase the total capacity of the port. I think you are more or less aware of these developments. This investment has been described as the most successful investment, the most successful foreign direct investment in Greece, especially in the years of financial crisis. And here we can have a short look about the results of these investments during the last years. So compared to 2007, when Piraeus Port, it was not a member of the top 15 container terminals of European Union, now it has a huge increase. It has the fastest increase between these ports, and now it's number six according to the data of 2018. The total throughput raised from about 1 million TEU, the term that we use to count containers, to close 5 million TEUs in 2018. And we believe that this year we will achieve to make Piraeus number one container terminal in whole Mediterranean. So this table, I think, describes very accurately what has happened in these 10 last years. And this win-win, the success story of the port of Piraeus, which goes on, and this development in the container terminal goes on with the same very fast increase. Now, apart from the container business, we must also refer that in 2016 we have another very important development, was the completion of the privatization of the whole port. So now there was a new tender from Hellenic Republic Asset Development Funds for the management and development of the whole port activities. Again, the winner of this tender was COSCO Shipping. So since August of 2016, COSCO Shipping has the management, is the major shareholder of Piraeus Port Authority, and has signed a long-term concession agreement with the Greek government until 2052. Now we will focus in other activities that they show great interest for further cooperation, and one of these is cruise business. The Port of Piraeus was one of the largest cruise terminal in Mediterranean Sea. Mediterranean is the second most popular destination in cruise business after Caribbean, and the port of Piraeus has very big facilities. We have available 11 berths in order to facilitate the biggest cruise vessels in the world, and annually we serve about 1 million cruise passengers. So there is a room in order to strengthen our cooperation on this business, and by taking advantage of the brand name of COSCO Shipping to attract more Chinese tourists to arrive in Piraeus and start and enjoy their cruise from the port of Piraeus. This is a very important target, which we also share this target with the Greek government, and we mean to increase home porting, which is cruise companies, cruise itineraries to start and finish in the port of Piraeus. This will mean that the cruise tourists will stay more, they will spend more here in the local society. And in order to develop this activity, of course, there are some other steps that we have to implement. It has already established direct flight connections between Beijing and Athens, but also we have to improve the tourist facilities. That's why in the master plan of Piraeus Port Authority we have included the construction of four new modern hotels inside the port area in order to support this business and to attract more Chinese and European and American tourists to come in Piraeus and enjoy their stay and cruise trips starting from the port of Piraeus. Another very interesting activity, another very dynamic service provided by the port of Piraeus is ship repair business. Here again we have room to improve this business if we consider that this used to be a very dynamic sector some decades before for the Greek economy, contributing a lot in Greek GDP. But unfortunately, for various reasons, Greece ship repair business has lost a big share of this market. One of these reasons was the lack of suitable facilities in order to serve and to provide ship repairing services to vessels. Again, in the agreement between the new major shareholder and the Greek government, it was included in the mandatory, as we call, investments between the two parties. The development of ship repair business, the purchase and installment of a new floating dock that has been already installed and operates, is number 7, as you can see, in this part of the ship repair sector. And this is a Panamax-size floating dock with a length of 240 meters and gives the port the capacity in order to serve the biggest vessel of the Greek fleet, of the Greek ferries. And this is a very important development because up to now, these big vessels, in order to have their maintenance works, they had to remove to other shipyards abroad because we didn't have the suitable facilities to provide these services. So again, by using the brand name of Costco Shipping, which has an excellent know-how of this business, ship repair business, we strategically invest and target to make Piraeus a major ship repair base in Mediterranean Sea. We could refer other examples of this successful cooperation, for example, the car terminal developments or the logistics center that we plan to construct again in the port of Piraeus in order to provide further and boost the supply chain services. For saving of time, we will remain on these, the most important, let's say, developments, and we can further discuss, if you wish, later on this. As a conclusion, there is clear political willingness, determination from the leaders of both countries to further develop this cooperation, this win-win cooperation. And for all these reasons described, we feel more than optimistic for the future growth of the port of Piraeus, which, as described, has also a positive impact, not only in the local society, the national economy, but in general for the growth of East Mediterranean region. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Well, I have to attest what Professor Papasotiriou said when I visited the Chinese Museum to see the 40 years of growth and reconstruction of China. I was expected to start the tour by Deng Xiaoping's achievement. Instead, I saw Costco and Piraeus in the front of the museum. It also shows what I said in my presentation, that public works and big infrastructural projects is part of grand strategy. And it's not only part of grand strategy of China, it's also part of grand strategy of Greece, because the port and the railways and the repair facilities and the logistics center turn Greece into a transportation hub. And it also increased the tourist advantages that Greece has, and to add that Greece is becoming an energy hub. Next to Drapetsona and Salamis, it's Revithousa, which is a very important terminal to liquefy gas and put it in the pipelines and go to Europe. We are also building TAP, a transatlantic pipeline which transfers from Caspia natural gas to Europe via Greece. And from TAP, we also build interconnectors toward the north, Bulgaria and probably northern Macedonia, which will connect the Greek energy system to the whole European and Eastern European, including Ukraine. So, for Greece, infrastructural project, it's becoming part of the grand strategy. It was fascinating to hear what the port was doing, and it shows the Chinese strategic vision of managing to acquire this port, that this port was really what made Greece huge, what made Athenian Empire. It was the port of the Athenian empires. And the Chinese got it from for cheap, utilizing the window of opportunity and the strategic stupidity of the Europeans and the Germans, that they were pushing Greece to denationalize everything and sell everything and sell it for cheap. And now the Europeans are saying, oh, you created a Trojan horse for the Chinese, which they force us to sell it to the Chinese and for cheap. Anyhow, what was also fascinating from your talk is that Greece is becoming a rising port power which is threatening other Europeans' dominant powers, mostly in the Netherlands and the German, which also explain the hostility of these countries against the Greek maritime industry, that through tax structures and using the European Commission is trying to make it at a disadvantage by creating conditions that instead of having the Greek ship owners using Piraeus as a base, to give them disincentives and have them to move to Singapore or on Dubai. So it's a completely attack on Greece on this level, because they fear what you just have explained. I mean, that Greece is becoming a rising power and is threatening established power like Germany and the Netherlands. Professor Syrigos had a medical problem and will not be able to... a member of his family had a medical problem, so he will not be able to join us. But we will turn the crisis into the opportunity that we will have more time to for discussion. And no further ado, I would like to open the floor for questions, comments, and on these interesting talks that we have just heard.
I have a question.
Okay,
since
please.
In front, all
right.
It is about the potential of the port of Piraeus.
The potential that exists linking the port with the infrastructure behind the port. And there are two things that I would like to ask. The first, what are the plans and what is the feasibility of these plans to link the port with the airport and the tourist attractions as regards the ships, the liners that take tourists? This is one thing. And the other one, linking via land, railway and routes, the containers to be able to promote them to the north of Greece easily, quickly and in large quantities from the port.
Thank you for the questions. First of all, regarding passengers, we can note that up to now the port of Piraeus operates as a big transit hub for cruise passengers, which means that the cruise vessels arrive early in the morning. The visitors have some hours available to visit the center of Athens, Acropolis, Monastiraki, and then coming back and go on with their trip. This is something that I want to change because it has been studied that this type of passengers, transit passengers, do not spend much time and, of course, much money to the local economy. They use the provisions of the vessels inside, only visit museums here, and then going on with their trip. So the official target of the Greek state, and which also in cooperation with the port, is to develop home porting in the port of Piraeus. It has, as referred, the suitable depths in order to host the biggest vessels in the world. We are speaking about vessels with a length of 350 meters and transferring around 4,000 passengers. So it's like small cities, these vessels. And one of the major investments included in the master plan is the construction of new birthplaces in order to host these vessels. But still, Greece, Piraeus, has a disadvantage compared to other ports of Mediterranean if we consider that the customer base of the mass majority of these cruisers are Northern Europeans and pensioners and cruisers coming from the United States. And we have a disadvantage because of the longer distance of Athens from these countries, so they prefer to visit ports like Venice or Barcelona, closer to them, more convenient to visit. But now, with the latest developments, we strategically focus on the very fast-developing market, Chinese market, Chinese cruise market. That's why we try to establish a strong cooperation with this market by using the brand name of Costco Shipping in order to bring more Chinese tourists. We are aware of the respect, the love that Chinese show about Greek culture, Greek history. Also, there are love about Greek islands like Santorini. So all these are advantages in order to attract more Chinese tourists in order to come and spend 1 week in Greece and later in Greek islands and stay more in Greek country. So this is more or less is the idea to develop this activity. Of course, there are steps that have to be implemented, like the expansion of the port, the construction of a new modern cruise terminal, a passenger terminal, the construction of tourist facilities, because there is lack of such facilities, especially the municipality of Piraeus. But there is a strategy that we follow, and we believe that in cooperation, of course, with Greek government, because we need license for all this, this step by step we will implement. And in the coming years, we will see a very significant increase in the flow of Chinese tourists arriving here in Greece. And a short comment about the transportation of goods through the port of Piraeus. If we consider that about 5 years before this rail connection didn't operate and started to operate in 2013-14, it is very important the fact that now every week about 15 block trains depart from Piraeus in order to visit Balkans, to transfer goods to countries of Balkans and Central and Eastern Europe up to Czech Republic. Up to this point, Czech Republic and South Germany, we do have a comparative advantage compared to the other route that we describe,
for the goods to follow through Gibraltar to arrive in Northern Europe and then send the goods back. So we want to develop this project. Again, there are some obstacles, bureaucratic obstacles that we have because we go through, the rail goes through different countries. Now the Hellenic railways have been privatized and we expect to speed up their investment plan in order to have faster faster routes, because we do know that we have a disadvantage compared to the very fast trains of Northern Europe, or like German and Netherlands that referred before. But again, there is developments on this area, and that's why we described before that this is one of the next big things in the history of Piraeus, to take advantage of its geographical position as a hub center, and also by constructing new investments like the logistics center that we have included in our master plan, to give the opportunity to Greece to develop also as a logistics center.
Well, it's interesting discussion about tourism. Apparently the ports and the airports bring tourists, but unfortunately the tourists are attracted by weather and good beaches and not from our civilizational history, because the Greek state has completely failed to make all its history into a brand. I mean, you walk in Athens, there is just Acropolis and the museum. There's so many historical places. Piraeus is huge of historical places. You go in the States and they make a brand, a silly secondary battle that happened 2 centuries ago, and we have so much history here which has not been branded. And based on what you said, I mean, that the Chinese, they understand the civilizational aspect, and they come to Greece, but also they have to find it. And we don't branding, which is a huge problem and a huge failure of our branding as a state and also as in the tourist business. Another question, Professor Sekelaris, from the Economic University of Athens.
Yes, thank you very much. I want to make a clarification question to Mr. Demenopoulos on the, so I can understand a little bit better the business plan of this home boarding. So the way I understand it, the idea is that the Chinese tourists are going to come to Athens first, of course, then Piraeus, and then get there, and from there, with the base of Piraeus, basically spend some more time around. So, of course, this is a chain of activities. So I wanted to ask you described very well your part. There are 2 other parts that are essential for this. One is basically the Athens International Airport and all the airlines that are both the flights that will bring all these extra tourists to Athens. And secondly, or rather firstly, the travel agencies in Beijing and the rest of Shanghai and the rest of China that will promote this sort of activity. So if you can tell us a little bit what is happening in these 2 other links which are essential for this home boarding to work.
Yes, to be honest, I'm not aware of all these details. Only I can give a general brief that it's very correct that you said that the port itself cannot develop all this business, of course. That's why there is a need to develop a cluster for the development of the tourist business. That's why we're already in communication with international hotel chains for the development of the hotels inside the port. Also, Costco Shipping has already developed the communication with travel agents inside China in order to promote the port as a destination itself. The general idea, as you described, is that the travelers will arrive in Athens, then they can spend about 1 week around in Greek sightseeing, and later to have a cruise, 7-10 days in Greek islands, but also in other destinations, because cruise companies, they prefer to include much more countries in their itineraries. So there is also a close cooperation with Athens International Airport in order to accelerate this business. Also, it is an issue with a faster issue of visas for these travelers. So there are many open issues that we run simultaneously with cooperation, of course, with Chinese embassy here in Athens. It is challenging, but we believe a very promising project, the development of this business.
Let me use the chair's imperative to ask Dr. Song a question. I mean, you highlighted what China is doing to Greece, but there is the other side, what Greece is doing with China. And here the problem is that somehow Greek corporations find it very difficult to have access to the Chinese market, either because of your bureaucracy, your law, your protectionism. So one of the accusations about that the Europeans are making to the Chinese investments and the Belt and Road is that it's not really two-way street, that it's mostly Chinese street. So what are you thinking about the other side, how to level the field?
Thank you, Professor. I think relationship is for both sides. I think from our government level and the local government level, and also some organizations, and communicate to each other, and we will find ways to try to solve this problem. And we can invite some organization to come to Greece and introduce China. You know, from economic tourists or something like that. And also we can offer opportunities for Chinese students to come here, and then they can go back to China and introduce Greece. And also I think come here, every Chinese citizen is a bridge to connect Greece and China. We will do, we are on the way. Thank you.
No, look, I was not referring just persons and tourism. I'm referring to Greek products getting into the Chinese market. And I think that's a problem. And I think if we want to talk honestly and creating a trustworthy relation, this subject has to be put for consideration. Any other question? Sir, could you identify yourself?
I'm a researcher at the Institute of International Economic Relations. There's been quite an elaborate case by Mr. Demenopoulos on the port of Piraeus. However, there is also the port of Thessaloniki, which seems to be a rather frozen case, let's say. Is there any insight that the panel could provide on this area?
No. The question is, we discussed the advantages and the development and what has been done in Piraeus. But if I understand the question correctly, Greece has another major port in the north, which is in Thessaloniki. And the question is if you know about the plans of development. I can say some nasty things about this, but you first.
Very shortly, I wouldn't say that it is a frozen situation, because now the privatization has been completed. There is already a major investor there. Actually, it is a scheme which, apart from companies from France, China, and Germany, So there are also promising developments there. And we believe that the growth of Thessaloniki port would be helpful for the growth of port industry of Greece in general. And there are synergies that we can be developed between the port of Piraeus and port of Thessaloniki. Only this from me.
Yeah. The only thing that I can say is that in the West, it's considered that the privatization of Thessaloniki gave a great opening to Russia in the Eastern Mediterranean. That's what I want to say at the moment.
And Alexandroupol. Say a few words about the Americans.
It's crystal clear that the Eastern Mediterranean, which is the subject matter of this panel, becomes to interest to the great powers. The United States is the dominant maritime power after the Brits withdraw from the seas after World War II. So it has an interest on controlling Bosporus, Suez, and Eastern Mediterranean. After all, the fact that Greece is in the West had to do with the Yalta Agreement and its position on the sea, in the Eastern Mediterranean. Russians have an interest to come down to the Mediterranean, which means that they have to pass through Bosporus and Dardanelles and the Aegean. And any access to the Thrace Macedonia from them is strategically very important. The Chinese, with all these things that we are discussing, are here in the Eastern Mediterranean, but not only Greece. I mean, the way that I understand, Chinese companies are trying to get big contracts in Syria, Iraq, on the reconstruction after the war, and they have presence in Israel, they are building presence in Italy. So clearly, all the great powers are competing here. The great power which is absent is Europe, although this is part of Europe, because Europe is not a geopolitical actor, but only a geoeconomic actor. So it's natural to expect that. But you see, the beauty of a country like Greece is to read this interest and try to link its interest to the others by developing either infrastructure or common initiative, because that's the only way that we get out of the crisis and to become relevant, although small, as Professor Papasotiriou said, small but relevant. And if I may disagree with you, yes, we are small, but on the shipping industry, if, as you highlighted, and Mr. Laskaridis, we are the naval superpower, and therefore we are relevant.
I think this guy is yes, right. It's a very good question. And actually, in China, there is a hot debate about what kind of port we can choose. And I would like to say that Belt and Road is an initiative. And the government give the policy and would give you suggestions. And also state-owned company will come here, and also private company come to here and to negotiate with you and face-to-face. And, you know, businessmen would talk about profit and, you know, market, something like that. So, this prophecy said, that this is a very complex project. And there's a lot of, you know, things, work to do. So, yeah. Also, we should compete with other foreign companies fairly. Yeah. Yeah. Winner is winner, loser is loser. Yeah.
Any other question? Mr. Gikas. Gikas has a lot of experience in China, has stayed there, has married in Chinese, and probably knows China as good as the Chinese know the country.
Thank you, Professor Platias. I'm Christos Gikas. I have read Chinese politics and economics in the late 80s at the University of Westminster in the UK and Beida in China. My question refers to the previous session. We are talking about the Belt and Road Initiative, and many times they try to resemble to the ancient Silk Road. My question is, what are the characteristics of nowadays the Belt and Road Initiative, first, to the ancient Silk Road, and second, to the late 19th century great game between the Russian and the British Empire, containing each other from the access to the sea and to India?
Okay, if I can give a general answer, if you read Thucydides and how power is being created, it created power in the trade hubs and the trade route. So trade routes are associated with the genesis, with the birth of power. And that's very important for Greece because we are a trading state, taking the advantage of globalization and trading. Otherwise, we would have been a provisional country that wouldn't have been relevant. It was trading that made us have a huge maritime industry and taking advantage of globalization. So the trading route gives benefit and wealth. But wealth is one component of power. So it's natural states to compete for power and wealth. So if I can give a brief response, it's both. It's cooperation and it's wealth generation, but because wealth generation is a component of power, it's natural to have competition. So it's both a cooperative win-win, as the Chinese have said, but at the same time, it's also a great geopolitical game. These two coexist at the same time.
In the long run, one would expect a clash between China and Russia in Central Asia. At the moment, this is not taking place because they both, for different reasons, have frictions with the United States, right? And so they have an opportunistic alignment. But the ambitious way in which China, with the BRI initiative, is entering into what traditionally were czarist, not only Soviet, but czarist lands, one would expect would sooner or later result in some kind of geopolitical clash in Central Asia.
Any other questions?